Good evening and welcome again to another edition of Couch Potato. I'm Peter Couch Potato. Australian television, or television in Australia, was once regarded as amongst the top 200 television industries in the world. Certainly in the top 300. Or four-ish. The question is it still? Well, tonight we ask the question, Australian television, can we get it ring? Right. What precisely do you think is wrong with Australian television?
You can always pick a fake, can't you? That kind of thing would never happen on a real Couchman show. Never at the ABC, would it?
No way!
Or never, no. Good evening, everybody, and thanks for coming along for this final Couchman over Australia. Yes, after 4 years, we're bringing down the curtain tonight. I haven't counted exactly how many shows we've done in those 4 years, but it feels like a lot. We've certainly covered a lot of ground, and some thousands of people have sounded off about an awful lot of things. Now, the remarkable thing, though, is that in those 4 years, none of them has ever come to blows, and no one's lost control. Except there was once when I almost did. We went up to Canberra to cover the political party of the year. That was 1989. There was a big political reunion of past and present politicians at the Lakeside Hotel, and we went along. But Sir John Gorton did too.
You're insisting that I sit there, are you? Put a censorship down, on it? Well, really, why? Why don't you give me a chance to answer? To give something to you? Why won't you? I mean, Al's doing it. Why won't you?
Will you sit down, please?
You won't answer me at all.
Will you sit down, please, Sir John?
Man. No, you're a very strange man. If I don't sit down, why won't you answer me? Why won't you just sit there and let me say something?
Sorry, look,
and
look,
answer
look,
me.
Sir John, if you don't sit down, we'll just stop. Now, will you sit
okay,
down,
okay, let's stop.
Will you sit down,
let's
please?
Stop now. Okay, let's stop. Let's stop now. We'll stop now. Is that okay? Are you going to stop?
Am I going to have to get you evicted?
Yes, get me evicted.
Okay, will you sit down?
Get me evicted. Get me evicted now. Come on. Get me evicted.
Well, what do you do in a situation like that? No one's going to do that tonight, are they? That was one of Sir John's more memorable media appearances, and I certainly won't forget it. But little glitches like that aside, we do seem to have covered an incredible range of issues during the time we've been on air. I mean, everything from the economy and Australia's place in the world to things like the rights and wrongs of smoking. And the other day when I was going back through our files, it occurred to me that when you bring all these programs together, you get a fascinating insight into what Australia was like in the late 80s and early 90s, because our attitudes are all there. And there's a perspective on the things that worried us. Well, tonight I want to pick up on some of those things just to see where you think we've come with them now. Now, one of the things we discovered is that even in the liberated 80s and 90s, sex is still a very touchy subject. And it did rear its ugly head on a number of programs that we did, like, for instance, we talked about legalising prostitution in Queensland, and we talked about the pornographic video trade in Canberra. And do you remember the two New Age sex therapists that we had on the program at the end of last year when we talked about sex in the 90s? Alan Lowen is a psychologist. He's British, but he lives in Hawaii now. And he conducts workshops in Hawaii and worldwide to help people rediscover their sexuality. Well, that's a little bit of what goes on in Alan's workshops. You're having quite a time there, Alan. Annie Sprinkle, on the other hand, has a very different approach. Now, Annie is quite a character. She's a former prostitute and porn star, but she's also got a bachelor's degree in fine arts, and she's written well over 300 articles on sex. Annie's now doing a lot of work with women to help them rediscover their sexuality.
More like wild, like crazy wild. One, two, three, look up. Sexy. Breathe.
I've taken quite a few workshops, sex workshops, and I was very sexually experienced, but to have a teacher actually explain something to you, like how to breathe, or how to use the muscles in your genitals, or where to, you can place your mind, and how to have a full body orgasm.
I want to know what a total body orgasm is.
One of the things that has struck me as kind of amusing and ironical in recent years is that men who are so good at ejaculating very rarely have orgasms. You know, women have far more familiarity with orgasm than men do, and that's got a lot to do with the control that men have had imposed on them through the culture.
It's important to start talking about those things, about our orgasmic potential. Like, yes, we can all have a one-hour orgasm. I think it's important to start saying that because it is possible.
A one-hour orgasm.
And that
orgasm.
Way we all can expand our culture.
I really miss
that. Or that women...
Yes, well, it was a fascinating program, but it just about blew up the lines to back chat. I mean, Tim Bowden tells me he had more calls and letters about that program than anything else we did.
Kenneth Skull of Ballarat, Victoria, said at the time,
"You joined a prostitute, a psychologist, and Couchman, and spawned a monster."
The clip from the sex film you showed, Couchman, was so forced and blatant it left me unmoved. But though I am not shocked by uninhibited lovemaking on TV, after all, I've been there myself, I am embarrassed. I feel like a voyeur in a Paris brothel. Can't anything be left to one's imagination anymore?
Over the years, most viewers have looked to the ABC to provide a code of decency in their programs. But alas, how the mighty have fallen. We are all expected to be fashionably tolerant, and the only alternative is to switch off our set.
Well, I think that gets to the core of the problem. I mean, how do we decide what is acceptable on public television and what is not, and who is best able to judge what is acceptable? Now, are the television stations themselves the best ones to know what the people want? They have to be in touch with the marketplace to survive. Or do we need some outside control? Well, we have been there and done that, and despite all the best efforts of the Broadcasting Tribunal, everybody, but absolutely everybody from the Prime Minister down, seems to be complaining about what they're seeing on television. The Tribunal had nearly 7,000 formal complaints about television last year, and that was 4,000 up on the year before. So, what is bugging you about what you're seeing on television? Sally Brown, what worries you?
What worries me is we've got a typical dichotomy in society where we will not allow children to buy cigarettes or imbibe alcohol, and then we violate their minds with television. I wish television companies had the integrity and were concerned about illuminating our children, not destroying their minds. I don't think they're being responsible. I think they put ratings and advertising dollars in ours before educating our children and making them great human beings.
But what is it specifically that worries you? I mean, I know sex worries you because we heard all about that. The violence worries the Prime Minister, and it seems to be different things to different people. I mean, what specifically worries you about what you see on television?
I think it pulls down our family standards and our family values. I have had 7 children, 6 girls, and in ages ranging from 25 down to 4. Now, 20 years ago, I didn't worry too much about what was on television, but now I am constantly pushing that on-off switch, and I'm annoyed about that. Why should I have to do that all the time? Why should I have to police what my children watch on television? It should be a nice, educating medium, not this... I'm sorry to say it, but garbage most of the time. Mm. I gave myself the first dose of pornography that I've ever had in my life, and it made me feel ill, physically ill, to watch it. I won't tell you what it was. It wasn't on this station.
No, so it's basically, but it's sex and violence. It's a whole range of
violence,
things that you disapprove of.
I am trying to teach my children to be honest, to be mutually respectful of the opposite sex, to not have sex before marriage, which will give a lot of advantages that they will not be open to disease. Mm. They will have an emotional stability that you don't get when you start playing with sex before marriage.
Sure, but I take your point. You're applying standards to the upbringing of your children.
Right.
But then you also say you're applying the standards to the television they watch. You're exercising control over the set.
But I'm not always there. Mm. I'm not always there to please my children. And they stay up later. When 20 years ago, my children were in bed at 6:30 to 8:30. Now they're up to 11 o'clock. That's the accepted thing.
But isn't that your fault?
Not really. I mean, I can't force my children to go to bed at 11 o'clock. Have you tried forcing a child of 14, 15 to go to bed? It's very difficult.
Mm. Can I just point out one thing here? Because I'd like to just hear how you react to this. I mean, that particular program of ours, I mean, we had fearsome complaints on the telephone the night that went to air. We have a repeat the next day in daytime. And in deference to the possibility of children watching, we cancelled the repeat. Then we had people phoning in saying, where is the repeat of that program? I missed it. I heard all about it. I want to see it. And the reality is, I mean, that did happen. But, I mean, the reality is, these programs that people complain about so bitterly are the ones that rate the most. Is that a case, Tony Brannigan? Is it reasonable? Is that a grace oversimplification?
No, I think that's often the case. Certainly there are ladies like plenty of people in society like this lady here who believe that television should be uplifting. It should be part of the an extension of school, an extension of church, if you like. But realistically, television's a part of our society, and our society is a lot more than school and church, and television is certainly a lot more, or a lot less, depending on how you view it. And the reality is that sex does sell, and to some extent, violence does sell. I think it's self-limiting to some extent. Excessive violence certainly doesn't sell. Mm. And
So how do television stations exercise that sort of judgment? I mean, I know that's an almost impossible question to answer because you're exercising a whole lot of individual judgments with every program, I suppose, aren't you?
Sure. It comes back to what you were saying earlier. It really always has been a partnership between regulatory authorities and television stations. I think the regulatory authorities have seen their job as basically drawing the ring, if you like, and have quite sensibly taken the view that it really is up to individual television stations to make decisions within those broad lines that they've drawn. Now, obviously, they try to take community attitudes into account in drawing those lines. Mm. It's very, very difficult in a complex society like we now have.
Well, that's the central point here. How do you decide what community attitudes are? I mean,
That's the issue for public policymakers, Peter. I mean, what is community attitudes? It's going to move over time, and it certainly has. Mm. And you have to recognise that with the proliferation of services, I mean, if we get to pay television, we're going to have many more channels, but you're going to actually pay for that. Most of us are very concerned about free-to-air, what comes across now, and the access that is enabling for children particularly. And I think the change in community attitudes and the programming that's being put on the stations is not in sync with each other. And I think that probably what's happening is that many in the community, and certainly as a public policy maker, we're seeing the product of the complaints going through the ABA and so on, that we have to remember that it's not going to be enough just to say you, the station, can voluntarily decide what community attitudes are. We want to say too.
Yes, Paul, you go ahead.
Peter, that's precisely that position has just been taken by the Parliament in the new broadcasting law, where the commercial networks have been asked to develop codes of practice for self-regulation of what we see on television, generally speaking. And that process has so far been disappointing. Mm-hmm. If we are to test this, and I agree, if we're to test this moving an amorphous question of community attitudes,
what is a community attitude?
Then we need to listen to the community. And the self-regulatory processes that the commercial television networks are so far looking like establishing won't, in our view at least, test the community's attitude sufficiently. Moreover, there needs to be a sanction. We can all try to be good, but when we fail to be good, what will happen? Now, it's true, as the person who wrote the letter said, you can switch off, but there may need to be other more subtle approaches than that.
Peter, you can't always switch off. I have four children aged between 5 and 11. To give you an example of when you can't switch off, they were watching a children's program 2 o'clock on Saturday afternoon. Benji. Now, one would imagine that would be safe. Fortunately, I was sitting there watching it with them eating lunch. In the middle of the program, it was on country television, and an advertisement came on. Now, one cannot in any way anticipate the ads. The ad consisted of a number of women in G-strings and barely anything on top, advertising some British program, group of women wandering around Australia doing playgirl shows in local pubs. Now, how are we going to be able to switch off? How can we regulate that? Surely standards must be set. This is self-regulation. This is the television's standards that are being set by the stations, and they will allow this sort of advertisement in the middle of a children's program where we cannot anticipate it and therefore cannot just turn off.
I suppose there'll always be lapses in discretion, but look, how do you react to this point that commercial television stations anyway, go out of business if they lose touch with what the public wants? And surely that has to make them the best judges of what...
I don't think so. I mean, that's like saying that tobacco companies are the best judges of how they should go about advertising and what sort of health warnings they should put on their product. There's dollars there, and there are people who will buy cigarettes even though they know what damage it can do. And I think that's probably the closest analogy to what we're talking about here. Advertising companies make millions of dollars a year annually profit based on the fact that images affect us. Images determine how we see people. And yet when it comes to this issue of portraying women as sex objects or people as just objects to inflict violence on, somehow we allow the television stations to set up their own standards. Yes. I think that's totally inappropriate.
Yeah. Well, look, yes, Tony Brennan, come in, but I was just going to say, if a television station gets it wrong and a lot of people do start switching off, they're going to get the message very quickly through the ratings, which come now in 24 hours.
Not so.
But that doesn't happen with cigarettes, you see. People still buy cigarettes, and yet we've decided that we will not allow advertising of cigarettes. Now, we'd wish that more people stop smoking. People know the facts. Human beings will still make choices, frequently wrong ones. And they will still watch programs that are harmful for them because that's the nature of humanity for some people. I think we need to take the same sort of stance we've taken with cigarette smoking and say, look, this is a public venue. It's public television. What you watch on your pay TV is another matter. But I don't want to have to be sitting up all hours of the day, as was mentioned here with my friend, or in the early hours of the evening, watching what my children watch on public television, for crying out loud.
You then have to set up some big watchdog, presumably some bureaucratic watchdog or committee, that then is charged with deciding what is community attitude and dictating for the rest of the community, don't you?
Yeah. Well, surely.
The points seem to be always about sex. Like, sex seems to really worry people. Mm. And then we get to violence. We aren't sure about that, I suppose. I don't know whether people would mean violence in the news, or they mean violence in a Rambo show, but what other things do we worry about in television? Do we worry about false views of history that are paraded? Do we worry about the fact that as kids, the baby boomers, all we were fed was American soap opera, and that's all my kids get on television now? I mean, those questions of quality are important, and history and social reality, but people just sort of focus on sex. And then there's this idea bandied around too, that there's a direct link between seeing some sex on television and violence in the society. I mean, that's one that's got to be
thought
about.
The great difficulty is in deciding what is excessive violence, because I bet if I asked everybody here individually, showed some examples, I would get a different response. Everybody would have a different idea of what the limits are.
But Peter, that's a second issue.
You know what he was saying before about cigarettes and smoking, it's an addiction. How many thousands of dollars is Australians paying out for rehabilitation purposes for people who are addicted? Now, pornography has been proven to be addictive. Once you've seen it, and I can prove this myself, I read a pornographic book of my daughters. The first time I was shocked out of my head. The second time, it wasn't too bad. The third time, I said to my husband, this is frightening. This doesn't seem as bad as the first book, but it's exactly the same. It's addictive, and it crumbles your moral value. It just, you know, it's very...
What was it, actually?
I'm not telling you.
It was sort of real R-rated stuff, was it?
No, it wasn't real R-rated stuff. It was on the cover, looked quite acceptable, right? And I was going to enjoy this book that my daughter had read, but there was a few pages in it that were really, for me, offensive, and I didn't like it.
But doesn't this get to the core of the problem? It shocked you, but it obviously didn't shock your daughter.
It's a very dangerous form of elitism that these people deal in, that they want to impose their views on others. The public will decide.
The public will decide.
You look at a show like Chances, for example. Despite enormous publicity, it died a death, and it's about to be taken off the air because it simply had nothing else going for it other than some nudity.
Look, Tony Brannigan, you were going to come in here, I think.
Yes, it was. I find a lot of this discussion very curious. It's as if television is leading a charge towards sex and violence, whereas
it is.
Realistically, if you look at videos, and if you like 70% of Australians, you will probably hire anything like up to 5 videos a week. Without exception, videos are far more violent, far more sexually explicit than anything that appears on television.
But they're not public.
Every film that appears on television is classified AO, in other words, the sort of films that most people here are complaining about, is heavily cut before it appears on
the reality. The reality still cannot be denied. What you watch on television will affect what you think and the way you act. If this were not the case, commercial television stations would have been out of business a long time ago.
OK, so how do you set up some system where somebody arbitrarily makes a decision about all these things and says this shall be the standard? I mean, what would you do,
Paul? That's a secondary question.
Attitudes test is now the one that applies in the Parliament to just pass a bill in a bipartisan way, setting up the system of voluntary codes for free-to-air. And the test is community attitudes, and this is the nub of the issue. I mean, there has to be balance. We've got the lady here with one view, another person with a similar view saying we ought to be able to watch what we want to watch. But you have to also, at the same time, protect children. Now, what the Parliament is asked is for detailed research into what is community attitudes. They're going to change all the time. And what we're saying to Tony Brannigan and the free-to-air people is, look, you do have a responsibility, particularly with regard to children, to make sure that at news time, and they accept some of that responsibility, the test is, does the protection that they provide in terms of their editing go far enough? Is the categorisation system for movies, is it stringent enough? A lot of us say it probably isn't, and we want them to go further than what they are. But if we're going to set up a group of bureaucrats to sit in a dark room to make decisions for all of us, we might all end up with this lady's view of the world or this man's view of the world. And that's not balance, and that's not what we need.
How would you overcome the problem, Paul Chadwick?
Look, you won't overcome the problem that there is this divergence of views in society. I'd echo the point that there should not be a fixation on sex in this debate. It's much broader. It is a very controversial claim in the literature in this area to say that there is a causal connection between what one views and what one does. It's controversial, and I think that ought to be said, and we'll leave it at that. We won't conclude it this evening. Mm. But I'd like to make one point. There is a great difference between the entertainment function of television in our society and the news and information function. And that has to be considered too. One thing that does come out of the literature about how television affects children, and I think they're a group in the community that most people are very concerned about in relation to this debate, is that they can be greatly disturbed by what they understand to be depictions of the real world. Yeah. As distinct, they can apparently differentiate between fictional worlds.
I take your point. I take your point. And although there's been nothing conclusive in all this, I mean, you certainly have demonstrated that there's as much public division on this issue now as there was 4 years ago. But clearly the concern is for what children see on television. And somehow what the television stations and the community has to try and do is to find a balance between what is acceptable viewing for children and what is stimulating viewing for adults.
Anyone got anything else they'd like to say about...
Yes, me, Murray Bourne. The problem is the channels.
Yes.
See, if you go from Channel 2 to Channel 7, there's five holes in the middle. And then if you go from 7 to 9, there's two holes. And from 9 to 10, there's no holes. How come that?
Maybe that's the problem. but let's move on to another theme that's certainly been a central part of many of our programs. In fact, I think it's been a central part of Australian life over the last 4 years. This is a very different country now than it was back in April 1989 when we first came on the air. We have lived through the worst recession in memory. And a lot of people have been on these programs talking about how it's affected them. People in business, people on the land, working people. And underlying all this, there's been the central issue of economic restructuring and making Australia internationally competitive. Now, we've heard a lot about the level playing field in the last 4 years, haven't we? But we heard a lot more about it 2 years ago when we took the program up to Dalby in southwest of Queensland to talk to some of the farmers of the Darling Downs.
You can import peanuts from China, $300 or $400 a tonne, less than what we sell our peanuts for. Mm-hmm. In the case of navy beans or baked beans, you can import cans of beans from Hungary on the shelf for 45 cents as against the Australian product for about 75 to 80 cents. Now, that doesn't only affect the farmer. I mean, there are people down in the cities that make those cans and make those labels. But through federal government policy allowing these things to come into the country, we all miss out.
OK, so you're arguing that you want some protection.
I have no choice. I cannot compete with that sort of imports into this country.
OK.
Now, I asked the federal government and all politicians, do they want peanut growers or do they want navy bean growers? If they don't, for God's sake, bloody well tell us. so that we can try and get out of it.
I take your point, and this probably sounds a very cruel thing to say at a time like this, but if Australia can buy it cheaper from somewhere else, why should we pay you people to go on producing it?
Peter, we'll end up eating coal. About the only thing that we can do cheaper is produce coal, we'll end up eating it.
Are you people now seriously suggesting that you should be protected? Are you suggesting that Australia should be subsidising you people?
If you don't wipe the tax off our fuel.
If you see the successful contemporary economies in this world and have a good examination of them, you'll find that there are some import quotas to protect industries like that, and you'll find that there is some tariff protection. Now, why have we in Australia, as Rod Saul said before, a very small drip of water in a big puddle, why have we got to be the only free traders who are silly enough to jump into that dangerous pool?
Well, what do you say to an argument like that, Phil Riven?
Well, I think we've almost lost touch with what the real issues are. I think, firstly, on the level playing field, it never was a level playing field in the world, and it never will be. The best example of that I can give is that when Australia federated in 1901, it meant that your interstate tariffs and restraints disappeared. And yet Tasmania had a devil of a job trying to grow bananas in competition with Queensland. Queensland couldn't compete with Victoria on ski fields, and later on, of course, Canberra couldn't, you know, run an ocean regatta or compete with anybody. In other words, which simply means that I think if we're looking for some mysterious level playing field, it's never going to be there, because there are advantages that you have with a town or a state or a nation, and there are some where you make your own advantages.
Yeah, but sure, see, these people are saying, look, Australia is a drop in the ocean, and we're loonies if we think we can go out there and try and compete with the rest of the world on anything that even resembles a level playing field. We'll all go broke.
It's precisely because we are a small nation that we can't afford to put up barriers around us.
Exactly.
That we don't have the opportunity for exchange within our borders because our economy is small. That we must exchange with the rest of the world. The level playing field analogy was about Australia. And what it tried to demonstrate is that you shouldn't take from one Australian and give to another. Because by doing so, I mean one industry and give to another. Because by doing so, you don't create employment, you just shift it round. You don't create any employment at all. In fact, you destroy a bit. You certainly destroy lower living standards. And what's more, you also corrupt the process of government. That's how WA Inc. came up, by taking from one industry and giving from another.
You don't go along with that, Sally Brown.
I don't go along with that. I've watched it. I can tell you now, in the last 10 years, I have seen this nation slip. We have the highest, more unemployed people in Australia than ever before, 41% of youth in some areas. Yes. We have a dollar dropping all over the place. We have 75% of product on hardware stores being imported. We have 50% almost of supermarket stuff being imported. We used to be able to grow potatoes, grow tomatoes, we still can, but there's no protection. Make chalk, make cheese, make everything. It comes into the country. We have in the last 10 years developed an international debt from $15 billion to $170 billion. And if you want to pay it off, put a dollar a second on the table for 5,300 years and another $500 interest, and these loopy people in Canberra are still maintaining their right, and there are empty factories, increasing unemployment, increasing people cast, wasted human resources, cast out all over Australia, and they're sitting there saying they're right. And there is evidence of disaster throughout this nation, not caused by protection, caused by people that don't understand global common sense. I'll give you an example of level playing fields. Our citrus industry. In Brazil, they pay those pickers $40 a month, $1.30 a day. They then drop the tariffs. Orange juice comes in here from Brazil with a 5% tariff. They then say, get efficient. What do we pay our workers $1.30 a day?
Big
deal.
Or do we get out of the citrus
industry? Then they say, export it, and we try and get it into Japan, and it's hit with a 40% tariff. This is a joke. This is criminal. These men in Canberra and all their friends will die with debt on their hands, and I hope they do so that we can get on and be productive like we were 10 years ago.
What's the key to the productivity?
Common sense!
Well, tell us how to do it then. You've got to fix the labour market.
I've been productive for 21 years.
Well, what about the rest of the nation? The labour market's got to be attended
Could
to.
I
the taxation
tell you?
System.
I'll tell you very simply.
Anyone can do a summation of what
Get
the problem
rid of
is.
The 17
What's the
government
solution?
Departments that stop me being productive.
Well, why don't you go and read
start?
Fight back? Look, what you've got to do is identify the problem.
Reed,
you've
shut
done,
down, honey.
You've identified the problem, but you haven't said what
I
the solutions
give you 15
are.
I can answers when he comes back next year.
You have to identify what the solutions are.
We can do it if we're left alone.
No one has intended to
We can do it. We
solutions.
Have great Australians. The government doesn't help.
Look,
they're trying
to
kill us off. They've
the
increased
are.
The debt and we cannot ever pay it back,
okay.
ever.
Dermot Hannigan, I'll let you come in next.
Because
sorry, I'm normally
I've sold, containers of cheesecakes to Japan. I've made them myself and I've set up a business over the last 4 years. And the first container of cheesecakes we made and sent to Japan cost our company $120,000. We sold it for $90,000. We lost $30,000. Mm. The federal government, out of its taxes and charges on labour and the flow-through, made $40,000 out of that container. So my little company
right.
was 40 grand
yes.
down the tube.
Right.
The
yes.
next container I made, I lost $30,000 on, and the federal government made $30,000 on. The next container, I lost $20,000 on, and so on and so forth, until now I'm making a small profit.
Yeah.
The federal government has made $400,000 out of our activities. I've made $20,000.
Yeah, but Dermot, I think the point is, in your business, you are now making a profit, but you have demonstrated that Australia can sell cheesecake to the Japanese.
That's right.
And you're competing with the rest of the world. Yep.
That's
you're doing
right.
it.
We can compete, but we could be selling a lot more cheesecakes if we'd had some sharing by the Australian government.
Just let John Hyde come in here. He's been nodding his head furiously.
Okay, look, I mean, this is a terrific story, but you'd compete so much better if you every time you replaced a motor vehicle, you didn't pay an additional $4,000 to subsidise an industry that isn't internationally competitive. The reason now that you're getting close to the margin that you're not internationally competitive is that you're carrying on your back the burden of industries that are not internationally competitive, including orange juice and motor vehicles
definitely not. I'm not in one of the industries that John would be violently attack. I'm from the footwear industry. Now, in the footwear industry, it is not inside the level playing field. It is international, this level playing field. And they have levelled half of it. You can't level the other half. The other half of the level playing field, so-called, is 50 cents an hour they pay the worker in China. 50 cents an hour, 20 times less than we pay our workers here. So that level playing field is never going to be level. It is a total myth.
So and John Hyde and, for Phil Ribbon perhaps this time, are we going to try and compete with that sort of situation?
Well,
or are we just going to get out of footwear altogether?
Well,
so
we should get out of industries where you're not going to compete over a long period of time. I often wonder if we shouldn't go back to basket weaving.
So we stop making and growing stuff.
Phil Cleary, yes. Get Phil Cleary.
These arguments have been discredited. The idea that at a particular point in time you determine what comparative advantage is absurd. We know that historically. Countries have worked through that one. Japan didn't do it. If Japan had followed these policies, it wouldn't have existed in the form it has today. It planned, it had a program, it said we can make particular industries competitive. You don't take it at a certain point in time and say, there's the point, there's the starting point, it can never go anywhere. And look, the free traders represent particular vested interests, and that's one of the problems with this argument. You get the mining sector, which pushes a particular line. Plus, also, ask the free traders a cultural, philosophical question. What industries do they want in Australia? What does Australia actually have to look like? What do they want to make? And what do they want to distribute in Australia? Because it is absurd the way they talk. They have no sense of history or culture. It's just this absurd level playing field, this absurd international competitiveness, and it doesn't work, and other countries are not so stupid.
Right, so then, well, look, that's a good point that we should go to. Is the extension of this argument, if we can't compete with the rest of the world in some industries, we should get out of those industries and go into industries where we can compete?
Is the answer quite...
Tell us which industries can compete. The answer quite simply, Peter, is yes. The fact is that every time you impose a cost on an imported product, you put up the cost to those industries that are competitive. Now, we have got industries in Australia that are competitive. You're sitting next to one.
Three quarters of the manufacturing.
And why are you loading? Well, the one I'm in, the grain industry, the wool industry,
mining.
The meat industry.
Where is it? Mining?
Look at the
wool competition.
No, look, just hang on a moment. The fact of the matter is that those industries that I've just described are competitive. And the absurd thing, look, take a very absurd example in this country. Wool, meat, grain, tourism. Iron ore, tourism. We're competitive. The cheesecake industry that's just been described, that's a competitive industry because he's made it competitive. Now, why the hell should those industries be loaded up with extra cost? What we have to do is move all of our industries into the area where they are competitive, not load extra cost onto those industries that are now competitive. It'll put them out of business. It is not a zero-sum game, taxing your competitive industries to subsidise industries that will never make it. And if you look at Phil Cleary's argument a moment ago about planning ahead, we tried to have 5 motor car manufacturers in this country, less than the size of New York State. The Americans must think we're a joke. We could not make those things competitive, and in the process, we put out of business industries that could have been.
Phil, do we, in very brutal terms, say, yes, look, no navy bean industry, no footwear industry, because the Chinese or the Hungarians can do it so much cheaper, we just can't do it. We'll go into something else.
One thing, Peter, I must do is the greatest lie that's been foisted on Australia in the last 4 years is to say that the foreign debt which we've got, which is now $160 billion, is due to the fact that we're importing more goods more than exporting. That is a lie. For the last 20 years, we have run a surplus on our exports over our imports of goods. And we are now $8 billion in front of where we were in 1972. The $160 billion is lost totally out of trading in services, nothing to do with goods. And it's there in black and white in the Bureau of Statistics figures. One of our fastest growing industries virtually didn't exist 30 years ago, and that's called tourism. It is now twice the size of agriculture, which is 204 years old. So there are career paths and there are jobs, and there's hundreds of thousands of them. And I think that we ought to be aware also that 9 out of 10 new jobs in every developed economy in the world today is in the service industries. And if we think we've got to go back and, you know, resurrect industries that were sheltered workshops for years when we've got a bonanza of new jobs available to us in the future, we'd be crazy. And I think parents ought to know there is a stack of new industries out there and we shouldn't worry about the old ones.
Right, well, look, you've demonstrated very clearly tonight that Australia still hasn't resolved this argument, not in 2 years, not in 4 years. And I find that a bit frightening because we're really debating Australia's future here. And it's going to be fascinating, I think, perhaps in 10 years' time to look back on this discussion tonight and see what we make of it in the light of where Australia's gone between now and then.
We have a couple of television people who used to own television stations in the audience, Deirdre and Alf Thimbleton. Deirdre?
Yes, well, Alf left the water board with a lump sum of $47,000 and we were going to put it into a little business like a milk bar, but then our bank manager said he'd be prepared to lend us $600 million to buy a TV network.
And what did you see as the advantages of owning a television network?
Oh, well, we didn't have to prepare sandwiches.
And how did your investment pay off, Deirdre?
Well, what with bank interests, we owe about $2.5 billion now. So, on balance, I think we probably should have stuck with the milk bar.
It might be good advice there. But look, one of the other fascinations of the late 80s and early 90s has been the flirtation that, well, thousands of Australians have had with the New Age movements. And our search for meaning has taken us through programs on regression therapy, codependency, astrology, and channeling. And in fact, it was through channeling that we met Ma Fu. Now, for those of you who don't know about Ma Fu, he's said to be the spirit of a man who last lived 1,000 years ago in Pompeii. And his followers believe that he manifests himself through the body of a woman in California who now calls herself Paramananda. And when she came on the program, she told us a little bit about this.
One day, as my husband and I were talking about this particular phenomenon that was going on in our life, I mean, you can't imagine, dishes would fly off the table, we would wake up and windows would all be open, just different bizarre things in our home. The bed I'm sitting on, Tony had just gotten home from work and I was very hysterical, and he was sitting in the bedroom on a chair, the bed I was sitting on started to levitate, and then it fell onto the floor, and that's when Ma Fu appeared. We went running out of the room, very frightened, and he appeared and came after us walking to talk to us.
What did he look like?
Michael was very, very tall. He looks like he's about 35, 36 years old and dark hair. And he was very, at that time, I was less able to see him as clearly as I do now. Mm. But for both of us, he was very strong, very large. He had on robes and very, very tall.
I think perhaps I should ask you if you could call in Marfu.
Love and masters, good evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
You are Peter.
I'm Peter.
I am Mafu. I understand you don't want to sit and meet with me directly. It's all right. How are you?
I'm feeling very strange. Yeah.
There's nothing I've heard so far that a good actress couldn't do, or even a bad one for that matter. I would, however, be most impressed if you could levitate your chair up for us.
As I would be impressed, Father, if you would find a bit of self-love.
Could Matthew say a few words for us in Latin from the time of Pompeii when she was a leper, please?
The question of the validity of what I am and how I have lived.
Please say something in Latin. You did speak that in your last life. Surely you can say one sentence. I mean, you should be able to remember that from when you were a Catholic.
Well, that's Marfu. Some believe, some think it's all a terrible con. But you all believe, don't you?
Do you still believe? Because this is going back 2 or 3 years now. I mean, Jill, you actually sold up everything so that you could go over to California to actually spend time with Paramananda and Marfu. So just tell us why.
It's very difficult after what's been going on beforehand because that seems so real and so down to earth, and what I'm talking about is beyond that. It's spiritual. And I suppose as I was listening to everyone talking and I was thinking how passionate I used to be too, because I'm a journalist. And I used to be passionate about causes and have a lot of opinions about many things. And I guess it's like if I'd had a heart attack and if I'd come through a crisis of life. Mm. And I suppose that was like the opening of this spirituality within me.
Now, Lisa, you and Michael were followers, weren't you?
Yes.
Still are, yes.
Yes. For me, it's never been a question of whether I believe or not. I met Marfu and I just felt a connection with him and I could feel his love, and it just felt a very profound thing to be in his presence. It wasn't something I logically weighed up, do I believe or not? It was more like something I just felt in my heart.
What about you, Michael? Because, although you're together here tonight, in fact, your marriage has broken up, I think, since Marfu was in Australia, or Paramananda was in Australia.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is that related to this?
No, it's a separate issue.
It was just something completely that happened, yes.
For me, Marfu has afforded me an opportunity, giving various tools and techniques of what I call self-realisation, to journey inwards to the inner world of me, to a place where I guess not many people really get to touch, because they're so, like listening to these people here tonight, I too have been a part of that and have felt that emotion within me as represented from outside. But what I do now is not take in so much what's happening outside, but I fill it up from within.
Mm. Were any of you ever religious people in the sense that you belong to any of the Orthodox religions?
Yeah.
Yes.
You all were?
Yeah.
You weren't? No.
I've been a born-again Christian and Pentecostal movement and Baptist
church. So what does Marfu give you that you weren't getting from that sort of thing?
To me, they take you to a certain level. It's more like a worship of an idol rather than the ideal behind what has been said by all religions, as far as I'm concerned.
So you see, the question that comes to my mind is, why are so many people like you either turning away from conventional religions to this sort of stuff, or people finding this sort of stuff as a way of making meaning of their life?
What are the numbers that are turning away? Is it a matter of people perhaps deserting the established churches and becoming more neutral? But are they going this far to being conned by this sort of thing?
Yes, quite a lot of them are going this way. I find a lot of young people especially looking for something that the orthodox religions or orthodox churches aren't giving them. And that's why there's so many sects and isms and ologies and all of that. It's as if...
Well, Brannigan's going to fix that.
Well, that's fine. That's his...
Sex rather than sex, I think you were saying, Lynn, weren't you? But Sandra Coughlin, I think you say this was all foretold in the stars, didn't you? This move to the New Age movement?
Well, there are certain things going on at the moment in the universe that indicate that this is going to happen, particularly throughout next year, but it's been happening for about the last 20 years, really. There's something called a Uranus-Neptune conjunction that's happening that is really creating the spiritual awakening for people.
That's all because of the Neptune-Uranus conjunction?
Well, not all because of. I think we're evolving to a point at the moment that we're looking for something more, more answers that the church simply can't give us. Mm. We're no longer the people that blindly accept what the church tells us and live in fear of a God. Who's going to punish it?
Yes, and yet there's a lot of blind faith here, because these people just blindly accept that that's not an act, that is the spirit of an ancient man coming back and manifesting through...
Yes, I think sometimes the pendulum has to swing. I think sometimes people have to go a long way in one direction before they find a balance and come back.
Exactly. Mm. Don Bernard, what do you make of all this? Because you've been a Catholic priest, you've been very involved in Catholicism. What do you make of this sort of movement?
Well, I have two concerns that I think I see emerging here, which were a concern of mine with organised religion and sort of the more established religion, that it's the loss of identity and the escape from reality and the search for certainty. And as I hear a lot of the economic rationalism coming from over there, I mean, this is like a form of mystical rationalism. I mean, there's been a passage through the established churches to the charismatic churches, and now there's this movement to...
To mysticism.
To mysticism.
So do you find some sympathy with it? Do you understand it?
No, my sympathy is with the spiritual side of people, which I think just gets caught up in these organised movements. And I think it's the people who suffer, and I think it's the spiritual side of all of us that suffers when we're caught up in this. And as a psychologist, I mean, what concerns me more than anything is the fact that we need to engage reality. That's the basis of mental health, is to get to encounter
to engage
the whole
reality,
of reality,
not run away from it.
That's right.
Oh, but there again.
But if I could...
I mean, I'm sitting here looking at a lot of red faces and a lot of purple veins and necks earlier, and over this side there's people looking very calm,
it's the
collected.
The right brain.
Exactly. You know, and
but
we talk
these
about
people
mental
would
health,
say,
don't we have more?
You're all sitting in the deck chairs on the Titanic over here.
Well, we'll go down happy, won't we?
You wanted to make a point, did you?
Well, I have been involved with Mafu's Wisdom as well for a few years now, and it is really totally irrational. And for me, I'm still working with my rational mind that battles it, that wants to understand it. My heart says something totally different, though, and that's the different place that it's coming from that is totally. Totally illogical. Mm.
Well, what are you people with the red faces and the purple veins in your necks make of all this?
I think it's wonderful that you have done this. And I didn't work putting two shows together, but it was really good to listen to that lady after us screaming and shouting at each other. I mean, I'm not on your side of the ledger, but I admire your calmness. I really do.
I just want to hear what Peter Ford has to say about this, because in a sense Shirley MacLaine started everybody on this track, didn't she, when she started telling us about all these other lives?
She became the public face in the 80s of it all, but people are throwing away their crystals by the truckload at the moment. I mean, the trend is very much against all these New Age philosophies.
This is in the United States.
In the United States in particular, because so many of the prophets and the teachers and the channelers are now proved to be absolute charlatans. Mm. And I feel sorry for people who are being roped into it all, people who are selling up their home and giving up their establishment here to take on Ma Fu and her like. I think it's very sad, and the time will come when they'll regret it. And there's nothing wrong with searching for some kind of belief or fulfilling a spiritual void in yourself. There's nothing wrong with that. But I just think it's a shame people are being attracted to that, because whilst the established churches certainly probably are left wanting in a lot of respects, they do have a record of great community service in hospitals or orphanages or whatever, whereas there's no evidence of that at all in any of the New Age philosophies. They are simply profit-making exercises.
OK, what do you make of all this, Paul Chadwick?
Peter, I wanted to make a small point, which was I've watched your expansive gestures and I feel bracketed. I'd
I'd like to make it perfectly clear that I'm here in the search for meaning in television self-regulation.
Someone's done our auras. What? Come and show us. Come up front and show us. Show us our auras before we go.
My name is Genevieve, and I'm a seer.
Yeah, and what's this? Here? This is the aura.
Yes, this is your aura.
And what does all this mean? It just looks like a lot of colours.
This is the malways to your life.
Uh-huh.
This is the map. This is the movement. These are your chakras, yeah. And this is your energy.
And what is it?
Must be very proud of your energy.
What does it say about
you
next year?
You brought it with you from your last life. And I would like to say to all these people who are worried about 1995, have you looked at 2035? Are you just looking for yourselves? This is the universe we are talking about. Not just one planet, not just one place. We have all come together on this planet for a reason.
This is sounding like a sermon. I'm getting frightened here. I'm getting very edgy.
No, thank you. Yourself.
You've struck them all dumb, which is probably a good opportunity for me to get out of all this.
Did you know you chose your parents?
I chose my parents, right. Okay, yeah, final word, Jill.
Asked originally why people are turning against religion and to the New Age, and I believe it's because with religion they say that God is out there, whereas the New Age, But you see, I think that the church says it is. You know, I mean, that's why I hear it.
Okay.
Do you know Christians believe that the New Age movement precludes Jesus Christ? It doesn't.
I'm going to interrupt here because I'm on appallingly dangerous territory here. Because I was reminded before we did this program that you should never talk about sex, religion and politics. And we've done all three, for heaven's sake.
She's been looking for a way out for a while.
There is somebody in the audience who claims to be a channeler who can fill themselves with the spirit of a 4,000-year-old television executive from Atlantis. And I think, Madam Tofu, if you could just fill yourself with that presence.
I am channeling now.
Fox 474, you pick up a direct here. No, not you, Fox 44. This is not your pickup. You are not the first cab on the ring.
We have to go, but thank you so much for coming along tonight. And I have had such a wonderful time over the last 4 years listening to people like you talking every week, and I think I'm going to miss it. Thank you so much indeed. And thank you to all of those who've watched us and joined in from home. I know you have, because you've written and told us so. And it's been just great tonight to be here with our crew in Melbourne. Some of them, Sonna and Daryl and Roger and a few of the others, they were here on the very first show we taped 4 years ago. It's been just a pleasure to work with such pros, people. And, of course, the people in the office upstairs who've done all the hard work to make these shows work, I will never forget you. They've made me look good week after week. They've tried to make me look good week after week. And I do appreciate everything. Thank you, everybody, and good night.
In 1969, I thought I was pretty radical. I was 21 years of age. I look at my son, who's now 18, and a lot of the kids that I work with today, and they make me look like a conservative.
Females like romanticism in relationships. Males have difficulties understanding that, and they have difficulties knowing what to do with that.
This is not music. This is noise. There is no recognisable beat. There is no melodic line. It's a gimmick. It's a vast gimmick.
When I kissed you and called you sweetheart, you ain't
nothing but a hound dog. Elvis doesn't need any impersonators to carry his name on, because Elvis's name went down in history many, many, many years ago. In the real world.
why did you leave Chances?
Because I wasn't prepared to do nudity.
Right, well, that's a pity because Couchman's nude tonight. But anyway, go in and enjoy your night.
Right now.
Please go in and enjoy yourself.
Rash. Rash for fans.
Like, with all the good things that we need to take from the 60s, it's not a matter if we don't have an identity in the 90s. It's like we need to learn and we need to build on it.
I do want more muscle, I do want to get bigger, but I still want to retain my femininity. I don't want to go overboard. I've got a long way to go because I've only been training for 2 years, so I've got lots to achieve.
In 1966, I appeared on the then top-rating talent show New Faces on the Nine Network. And the so-called judges saw fit to award me a paltry 42 points out of a possible 100 for my interpretation of the sensitive ballad Love is a Many Splendid Thing. Are you familiar with that?
Well, I...
Suffice
certainly.
It to say that the heat was won by a singing poodle who had absolutely no microphone technique whatsoever.
Good. Well, I think you've made your point, so if you could just...
Love is a many splendid thing.
Well, that's about it for Couchman, and what an effect it's had on us all. Peter's given us politics and sport, humour, but above all, he's refused to do the one thing that nearly every Australian television host does when they get their own show, sing. Thanks, Peter, we appreciate that. What else has he done? Well, he's challenged, he's provoked, he's informed. He's also shown us just what can be achieved with really good hair care products. He's also done the show from overseas. He did it from Ireland and Gallipoli, South Africa, Bali. He didn't do a show from Bali. Just lay on a beach and read a Wilbur Smith novel, but you get my point. A lot of people have tried this sort of show and failed. So why was Peter so successful? Impartiality. The ability to ask questions without prejudice or personal slant. I'll never forget his show on psychic phenomena. He'd let each person have their say no matter how outrageous. He'd listen intently, wouldn't interrupt, and then as soon as they turned their back, he'd go... Yes, Peter Couchman is an ABC icon. An icon along with Bill Peach or Clive Hale. Bananas in pyjamas. I, on behalf of everyone at the ABC, want to thank him and wish him well in his next venture. What is it? Well, let's just say the Sheepdog Show is going to have a new host next year. Mum's the word on that, right? Good night.